have to be balanced together. The next slide talks about the elements which actually affects the project speed. The five project management elements or the facts which can affect the project speed. One is ineffective project communication, the most important one. So communication is very important. It's better to over communicate rather than not communicate or under communicate. Thinking that, okay, I will give only this information to this person, I will not give this information to this person, I will have a polarized communication. If you have that kind of an attitude, it's going to be very difficult. Then the next one is, how will you actually deal with a poorly defined requirement? Somebody is telling you in one line what exactly is the requirement, maybe your client, okay? Then how do you handle that situation is very important. It's very likely that many of the clients, because of basically they might themselves don't know how to specify the requirement, might tell the requirements in one line or as a punchline. So how do you handle those situations is what I'm going to talk about in the new slides. So then the third one is ineffective project staffing and allocation. Many times what happens is when somebody is asking for more resources, the resource manager will go to another team and try to say, oh, please give this resource. Mostly what happens is, normal situation, the other project manager who is having some resources, he may not actually release best resources. He may release to this manager the resources which he don't want. So what happens is, when you actually look at it, a manager might get a resource which is not really, is really very wasteful resource he might get. So how do you handle this kind of situation is what I'm going to talk about. The fourth one is poor team management. If you have a team, how do you communicate with the team? How do you handle the motivation level of the team? How do you make sure that the team members are happy and motivated and then to deliver the project? The last is the quality of infrastructure and the downtime. For example, if the person is highly energetic, a very brilliant guy, but his PC is very old PC, Pentium 3, which is very less megahertz and it doesn't have RAM, in between it hangs, it actually has to go for a lot of, I mean, it's like a horse working with a donkey. So it becomes very difficult to achieve the overall speed when you have a difference in speed. Both has to be energetic, both have to have, the machine as well as the human being should have the same kind of speed. Okay, let me get into the first one, the project communication related fact. So on the left side you can see what are the contributors of this fact and how you can really prevent each of the types of fact. Okay, this is all about how the manager or the team lead or the project lead really communicates with the team. So one of the thing is providing only partial information before allocating project tasks to team members. Pruning the information. Some people feel that, okay, I don't have to really give all the information to all the team members, let me prune. Let me take a second paragraph and give to Mr. X. The first paragraph let me give to Mr. Y. So what happens is there is the same amount of information is not available to all the team members. So what happens? How do you really prevent these kind of things? So we have to, as a project manager, we have to set the context. We have to give big picture of the project. What happens in the project? Who is the customer? Who is the customer's customers? What happens if you don't deliver properly? What happens if the timeline is not met? What happens if the quality is less? What is the impact for the company as well as the project? What exactly happens if you don't deliver the right quality? So what is the real impact of this product and whether this product is going to fit in this overall system, how the system works? So you have to give a complete big picture of the product to the entire project team. The second point is about polarized communication. What happens is your project manager, he has got say 20 members, he will definitely have blue eyed boys, favorite team members. So what happens is he go and talk to favorite team members more than other team members. So he will give more and more information to favorite team members and less favorite team members may not get the right amount of information. One is that when there is not much information, your productivity automatically reduces. Okay, and also it can affect motivation. Suppose there is a stepmotherly attitude to a certain member and certain other members you are giving more airtime and more attention. So what is required? How to prevent these kind of things? You have to basically, as managers or leads, you have to maintain neutrality and objectivity in your communication to prevent team members when getting demotivated. Then there is also unnecessary email traffic and ping pong mails between heavyweights. Suppose you have very senior members and heavyweights in the team. So let us take, they are actually fighting over certain issue or certain technical issue, and you are a silent spectator to that, then actually it actually brings down, it's kind of fat which actually brings down the productivity of the project. So as project manager, it is not necessary to copy the whole world, okay, when having certain problems being, so what happens is, instead of copying the whole world in the email, it is better to go to the, those two heavyweights and solve the problem by sitting across the table. Sometimes phone and face-to-face communication works much better than in mail communication. Now, creating a sense of urgency with over-exaggeration and put undue pressure. Say that CEO is asking for this information, or CEO wanting this, or giving that kind of a connotation and putting a lot of undue pressure on the team member to create sense of urgency also can reduce a lot of productivity. So this is also, if there is no real pressure, don't put pressure artificially. Put real pressures. If there is a pressure, put it. Otherwise, don't put pressure from your pocket and put it. So what happens is, and also when there is real pressure, people who are actually taking risks and delivering things, reward them. And also give them some challenging tasks and put pressure. It is not that artificial pressure can be easily made out by team members. Ineffective escalations. What does it mean? Ineffective escalation are certain amount of escalation which you do without having the real clarity of the escalation. What for you are escalating? What type of problem you are trying to solve? Who has to actually attend the problem? If the problem is not solved, what is impact? All this information is required in an escalation. What are the suggestions to solve the problem? So all this, when escalation is something you do when some certain things are outside your control or you can't do anything. So you have to escalate to some stakeholders, your upper managers, or even to the customers. So basically, escalation is an art. So a clear problem statement at the right time basically will be able to solve the problems easily. Many times escalations are very weak or diluted, so the problems will not get solved. And also following up on the escalation is very important. How do you follow up on escalation is very important. Once you escalate, don't forget it. You have to go back, and till the problem is solved, you have to follow up the escalation. Then also, when you are likely to get an escalation from somebody from outside, it is better you go and tell your boss in advance. Rather than getting escalation from outside, it is better you go and tell your boss in advance. It's very important. Okay, the next slide. So I've taken a case study for project communication. Okay, this is assumption violation by customer. So let's take, there is a pre-sales proposal. It says the hardware will be brought up by the customer by date one. Actually, the project, so it says that in the pre-sales assumption, the hardware board will be brought up by the customer on date one. Sorry, there is some interruption. Okay, now the project just started 1 week before D1. Customer informed, they are unable to provide the software but can supply the hardware by date D1. But however, the delivery cannot be delayed as the business consequences are high. What does this mean? See, in the beginning, in the pre-sales, customer says, I will deliver hardware to you by date D1. But the customer, just before the date, 1 week before the date, says that, look, I'm sorry, I cannot deliver this, but however, we have a delivery to make, your software has to be on time. The customer will make unrealistic demands sometime. At the same time, they may not meet their own commitments. So you have to be careful, how do you handle such situation? Because customer also, when customer also become your supplier, how do you really handle the situation? It's very important. So what are the options before a project manager when such a situation is faced? First option is push your team, basically push the team to absorb customer delays. What happens? You push. So the team and making them to absorb those delays, making them to work on Saturdays, Sundays, weekends, make them stay overnight. All these actually reduce the motivation level. The second option for the manager is to replan and announce a delay. This what happens? In this case, you are telling that customer that, look, you have delayed it, so I am going to proportionally delay my deliverable and announce it to customer. The third option is negotiate with the customer that I will still deliver on D1, but what happens is I will deliver with a reduced feature set. Most likely, this option might be acceptable to the customer. Let us take I have to deliver 10 features, but a customer actually delayed in giving me the hardware. Now I'll say whichever hardware dependent features, I might deliver little later, maybe in the second sprint or in the second phase of the deliverable. At the same time, I will keep the first date D1 as it is. The customer may love this kind of suggestion. You may take it. So I'm not giving you any direct answers, but at the same time, I'm just explaining you all the options possible in front of you. Depending on the situation and depending on the context, you have to apply the right option. Let's move on to the next slide. Okay, now this is another type of fact. How do you handle poorly defined project requirements? Now let us take just to get the project, okay? Just to get the project, the pre-sales would have given some wild assumptions because there is always huge amount of competition, so the pre-sales would have given wild assumptions to get the project win. Now when the project is won, you will see that wild assumptions which you have made in your proposal is no more valid. So basically assumption itself is, if you convert that word, it is basically making ass of you and me. So basically if you have wild assumption, it gets underestimated. When you have underestimation, then you will go for shortcuts to do the project. When you have shortcuts, you will have lot of quality issues. When you have quality issues, you have to do lot of rework. When you have rework, your cost will increase. When your cost increases, your senior management will become angry. So all these are related to fact. So what is to be done? When somebody is telling you, okay, this is the requirement, what you have to do? What exactly you have to do to manage this? Somebody is telling in one line certain requirements. So make a set of questions to your customer. Ask the right questions at the point of receiving unclear requirement in or inputs. At the point of receiving the requirements, you ask those questions. Not afterwards, not after starting the project. When the requirements are getting received, at that time, go through that, or even if it is one-liner, ask a set of questions. Okay? Now you'll get a lot of answers. You make the requirement yourself and send it back to customer for approval. Another option is bulletize the requirements into some small sub features. Okay? For each of the sub features, assign clarity and complexity factors. For example, if you give clarity and complexity factors, what is the clarity of that requirement? What is the complexity factor of that requirement? Okay? Then what happens is you can actually take up the high clarity and high complexity requirement for your analysis. Okay, then you take up the clear, most wanted and complex requirements. So the requirements are clear, they are most wanted by the customer and they are complex to implement. Take them first and execute it. This is a good way to handle, how do you handle a poorly defined requirements. Now then what happens to the unclear requirement? Now you have only handled only the clear, most wanted and complex. What happens to the unclear requirement? Package each unclear requirement with re-estimate gates. So you say that this is unclear because of these reasons. So go back to the customer's door and knock at the customer's door to find out whether you can get it clarity, or you can propose certain requirements back to the customer and get it approved. This is the way how you basically convert an unclear requirement and then get back to clarity. Sorry, there are a lot of interruptions, but at the same time I want to make sure that my audio is not interrupted.